outrageous conversation on BCTV is supported by Brentwood.
Welcome to Courageous Conversation. Pastor Luther Routte here. My guest for tonight's show is the famous Joseph Eppihimer, who has been, but actually still is, the mayor of Reading, Pennsylvania. How are you, sir?
I'm fine, and thank you for all those comments. I really appreciate it.
Yeah.
I really loved that job when I had it. It's a shame, but I left, and I moved on in my life. But I really loved working with for the people of Reading.
Yeah. Well, you know, it seems that that's the pattern for you in terms of working for the people, being a master plumber, you know, serving people in that way. That was part of the training, I think, right? What do you think?
Well, yes, I was a master plumber for the Reading School District for 24 years. And then before that, I worked for a couple of different contractors in Reading. But I always loved it. I did work for other people that couldn't afford a plumber. A contractor, I did a little work for them on the side, so to help them out. I always felt that that was my job. It was always about the people of Reading.
Yeah, well, you know, that's you know, when you look at history as to what sort of motivates you. What were your parents like?
Well, my parents were, to me, in my mind, they were the best two parents I could have ever had.
Yeah.
But the thing is, they never had much. My dad worked in a hosiery mill. My mother was a stay-at-home mom and taking care of my sister and myself and my brother.
Mm-hmm.
And so we never had a lot, but we had the love of our parents.
Yeah.
And I guess maybe that's where I get a lot of mine, for the love of the people.
Yeah, that's really good, you know, to hear that. And I guess you graduated from Reading High.
I graduated from Reading High, and then my next door neighbor got me a job at Firestone.
Uh-huh.
He was one of the bosses down there, and I became a lab technician. I cleaned up the dishes. But I was in on a carpool that we used to go with other people from Reading here.
Yeah.
That used to go down to Philly, I mean to Pottstown to go to work.
Yeah.
And the one man was an elderly man, and he was in the sales department down at Firestone, and he's the one that talked me into going to college.
Good.
And I went to Akron University.
Where did
for that? A year.
Uh-huh.
And then my father lost his job, so then I had to come home.
Uh-huh. But how did you get into the plumbing?
My dad's brother, my Uncle Bob.
Yeah.
He was, he worked for one of the contractors. He was a plumber.
Uh-huh.
And he was like an office holder in the Plumbers Union.
Uh-huh.
And he's the one that got me an apprenticeship.
Wow.
I worked for Corbett's, Wirtz Engineering, a couple of different outfits.
Yeah. But that seems to be the foundational thing in terms of being able to understand how apprenticeship is a very good teaching tool.
Oh, yes, it is.
You know, and that's a German thing almost, you know. Reading Community College, you know, I served on their board of directors, and they began to develop, while I was on that board, an apprenticeship program right in the community college, you know?
Mm, yeah, well, I used to go down there to the movie theater.
Yeah.
You know, we went there to see a couple shows already in the past, but we haven't been down in there in quite a few years now. But I really have to look at when, like just now for Thanksgiving this year, we had a fly out to Wisconsin for Thanksgiving.
Oh yeah.
To spend with my son and that stuff.
Yeah.
And then my other son, we go up there, we drive up to him in Boston.
Okay.
Well, Franklin, Massachusetts.
Yeah.
For Christmas.
Yeah.
But it's getting to the point where it's just being too much to do, you know.
Yeah.
I wish they were living closer.
Yeah, that's all right. Yeah.
But they got their jobs and they got to do. They got to do.
That's true. But you know, I wanted to talk about, you know, the mayor of Reading as to what your experience was as the mayor of Reading. And what the problems that you had there, you know, what kind of problems were there? Back, you know, and this was 1999
to 2004.
Yeah, to 2004. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I never looked at it if I had problems.
Uh-huh.
I always just went and faced them.
Yes.
But I mean. I would say I was, I had 210 police officers.
Yeah.
I was the last mayor that I remember of that had a balanced budget.
Uh-huh.
Never raised taxes. And I mean, like I said, I always put the people of Reading first. It wasn't about me and my family, it was about my biggest family, and that was the people of the city of Reading.
Mm-hmm.
It was all about what I could do for them.
Right.
And then I did some plumbing on the side. Actually, there was a school, I still remember this. There was a school teacher that, because I worked for the school district.
Yeah.
And there was a district teacher that just called me a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
I was in my 70s
yeah.
at the time, and she asked me if I was still doing plumbing work. I said, no, I gave that up.
Okay.
And like I told you, I said, one of the kids that got my, I had a scholarship.
Yeah.
I started a scholarship, and we just gave out our last scholarships 2 years ago. Three girls at Reading High. They wanted to go to be nurses.
Mm-hmm.
And my scholarship was for nursing and for trades.
Yeah.
And then when I was in the hospital 2 years ago to get my kidney removed, my right kidney, because I had cancer. And my doctor told me, he says, Joe, he says, instead of trying to get in there and just get that cancer out, he said, it's so close to your blood vessels. He said, if I wouldn't get it all, you'd be a goner.
Mm.
So I said, well, you know, do what you gotta do.
Yeah.
And he took my kidney out.
Uh-huh.
And I mean, now when I was in the hospital and recovering from at the Reading Hospital, these two nurses come walking in my room to check on me. And we started talking and that stuff. And I said, I had a scholarship when I was the mayor of Reading for nursing. And the one girl says to me, she says, Mr. Eppihimer, I know all about it because I'm one of your nurses. And that's when I said to her, maybe you better give me your phone number. I may need you full time someday. But
yeah.
She was the second girl I ran into.
Yeah.
A couple of years earlier, I just went over for some tests. And I ran into one of the girls.
Yeah, well, that's your blessing returning to you, right?
Well, it's what I wanted to do.
Yes.
I just wanted to do it. I, I, I mean, and I told you before, that's I became such a great friend of Mr. Bosco. And basically, when I hear people condemn him because he had all that money and everything, it really irritated the heck out of me.
Uh-huh.
There was nobody that I ever knew in my life so far that did more for Reading than Albert Bosco.
Yeah, right.
One of the things I wanted to do, I wanted people to own their own homes. I didn't want them to have to rent houses from people from New York or wherever they're from.
Yeah.
And Albert called me the day, about a month after I was elected. And he asked me, he says, well, my secretary answered the phone and she said, Mayor, it's Mr. Bosco. He wants to talk to you. I said, well, send him through. So I picked up the phone. I said, good morning, Mr. Bosco. He said, good morning, Mayor. He says, are you busy? I said, I'll never be busy when you call me. Can you meet me at the airport in a half an hour? I sure can. I didn't even ask him where we were going. I just said, yeah, you know. And my secretary even said to me, well, where are you just going? I said, I don't know. I'll have to wait until I get there to find out. And when I got out there, he met me at the door. And he says, we're going down to Washington, D.C. to see the Secretary of HUD. This was under George Bush at the time. And because we didn't play politics, you know.
Right, yeah.
But that didn't mean nothing to me. The thing that meant something was who the person was.
Yeah.
And we would go down there and we'd go up into this building after we get checked in. And it says Secretary of HUD Martinez.
Mm-hmm.
And we go up and go in the room, the outside where all the girls are sitting around at desk.
Yeah.
And as soon as we walk in the door, they said, Mr. B, how you have? When we haven't seen you in such a long time, Mr. B. And I'm saying it to myself, it's Mr. Bosco. It ain't Mr. B. But I said, well, then he must have been here before.
Yeah.
So we started getting all the HUD houses in Reading.
That's what Martinez was selling at that time, to get the HUD houses.
No, Al Bosco was in charge of that.
Oh.
Al Bosco was, we would buy all the HUD, we'd get all the HUD houses for $1 or $10 from the federal government.
And
then we had to fix them up and sell them.
But you got it for $10.
That's what I can remember.
Okay.
And when we, because I know, I can tell you, I can even show it to you. Right up near where I live, on Linden Street, this is on Linden Street, a street below me. We sold a house there, one of the last ones we sold, for $38,000, a row home.
Yeah.
And I'll spend $100,000 on it. And then those people at City Park condemned Al Bosco because he had money. I said, guess what? If he didn't have that money, he couldn't have done it for the city of Reading.
Right, yeah.
Because I'll tell you what, he should go down in the history of Reading as the best supporting man, businessman in the world.
Yeah.
I mean, I'll tell you what, he did so much.
Well, that's a good story to hear, you know, in terms of...
That's one story I'll never forget.
Yeah, you know. Well, he still lives on with his stores because they have a very, very good philosophy and a practice, a business practice that people really enjoy and benefit from it. So he said a very, very good thing. Very, very good thing. So, still, we have Reading has many of its problems there that we see. Is this something I can get for you?
Well, I'm looking for my hanky.
Oh.
I don't want to have to sneeze.
Okay.
Every now and then I have to sneeze. I don't know what it is.
Oh, yeah.
comes on me all of a sudden.
Okay, no problem. All right, but what I was trying to get at is Reading itself has a lot of different problems now. Problems of adjustment. There's some criminal problems.
Yep.
Those kinds of things. And I was just wondering, how did you handle some of those things when you were mayor?
When I was a mayor that had the most police officers ever.
Okay.
I had 210 cops.
Okay.
Police officers. And today, they're lucky if they have 150.
Uh-huh.
Because I run into some of the police officers in Hamden Park.
Okay.
When they're taking a lunch break.
Yeah.
When I drive out that way, I always have a tendency to drive up to see if I can see any of them.
Okay. Yeah.
Because they remember me.
Yeah.
And they'll say, they've even already said to me, "Boy, we wish you were back, Joe."
Uh-huh.
And I was also the last mayor that I know of that had a balanced budget.
Okay. Yeah.
And I never took a raise myself.
Uh-huh.
I felt that what I was getting paid as mayor was more than enough.
Okay. Yeah.
I never lived high and mighty. I'm just an average guy.
Yeah.
And I'll always be that way.
Well, I guess that being a plumber, a master plumber, was a very, very nice thing for you. How's that? Mm,
thank you.
Yeah.
Well, when I was a master plumber at the school district,
yeah,
I did work for a lot of teachers and everything.
Okay.
On the side.
Yeah.
Help people a lot. And then a couple years ago, maybe 4 years ago or 5 years ago, I get a phone call one day
mm-hmm.
from one of the teachers.
Yeah.
And she's like 70, she was like 71 or 72, I think. And she says, "Joe, are you still doing plumbing work?" I said, "No." I said, "Not no more." I said, "I'm done with plumbing."
Yeah.
But I was always there to help people.
Yeah.
Well, and like I said, our scholarship, I had it started with a scholarship fund, and it was for nursing and for trades.
Yeah.
And we just gave out our last three scholarships
mm-hmm.
2 years ago. And they were the 37th, 38th, and 39th scholarships.
Uh-huh.
Well, and they were all for nursing.
Very well. Not just for nursing. Didn't you have other forms of helping with that scholarship? You did, like, on the trades.
Yeah, it was a young man at Reading Catholic
uh-huh.
that got my scholarship the 1 year,
uh-huh.
and he lived over in North 4th Street off of Spring Street.
Right,
him and his mother and dad. And he wanted to be a plumber. And he said he wanted me to, but it's my scholarship, he wanted to go to trade school.
Yeah.
And I said, "Why do you want to go to trade school? Your mom and dad have to spend all that money."
Mm-hmm.
I said, "What if I get you a job as an apprentice?" He said, I wasn't even thinking about that.
Yeah, yeah.
So I said, I'm going to get in touch with one of my friends, and his brother still has the business, I think, over there on Buttonwood Street, right between 3rd and 4th Street,
uh-huh.
on the left-hand side. And I got this, we met with him, and we met with the owner, and he says, "Yeah, Joe," he says, "I'm looking for an apprentice."
Mm-hmm.
Now, today, that young man owns his own business. Him and another guy, his buddy,
yeah,
own their own business. He used to come up to my house whenever I needed a little something plumbing.
Yeah.
And he'd take care of it. He said, "Oh, Mr. Eppihimer," he said, "I think I may have one of them in my truck."
Mm-hmm.
And he'd go out to his truck and he'd come back in and he'd say, "Yeah, I found one." And he put it in like a filter in my something, you know, like a toilet or whatever.
Yeah.
And I said, well, how much do I owe you? He says, I can never repay you for what you did for me.
Uh-huh. There it is.
And now he owns his own business.
Yes.
Him and another buddy.
Yeah. That's a wonderful story.
I mean, it makes me feel good that I did something great for people.
Yes.
To
yes.
help people.
That's
and just like with these girls about going into nursing.
Yeah.
I mean, nursing is a great profession.
Yes.
Profession to be into. And my mother-in-law was a nurse, and my one daughter-in-law is a nurse.
Yeah.
And my mother-in-law was one of the nicest people you ever wanted to meet.
Yeah.
And so I named it the scholarship after them, you know.
Yes. Very, very good. But the problem that we have in Reading is similar to some of the problems that they have in New York, you know. When I first got out of school, college, the first job that I got was being a street club worker in Brooklyn to work with teenage gangs.
Ooh.
That was my first job. It's very interesting, you know, how to be in there. So this was 1960. And one of the first incidents that I had was my gang, the Buccaneers, were arch enemies of the Marcy Avenue Chaplains. So that, you know, that their project was on Marcy Avenue. My gang, the Buccaneers, were on Sumner Avenue. This is in the heart of Brooklyn. And the police department had heard and had a report that the Marcy Chaplains had stolen a submachine gun from the Brooklyn Navy Yard. And they were testing it out on the rooftop. So the police said, you got to take the kids that would return fire. If these kids come down with a submachine gun and spray your area, you've got to take the kids out of the area that would return fire so nobody gets killed. All right? Mm-hmm. So I took those kids that I knew that would return fire out to the Apollo Theater in Harlem. They gave me a van to be able to take them out, and took them out that same night. And the police were able to capture, when those kids came down and started spraying, they were able to capture that gun. All right? Mm-hmm. And we went up to the Apollo Theater to see James Brown. He was the big star in 1960.
Well, that's just like the police officers I run into up in Hamden Park.
Yeah.
When they say, you know, one of the first things they bring up to me
yeah.
is about, you know, they wish they had as many police officers as when I was there.
Okay.
I think I was up to 210, and now they're only at about 150.
Yeah, right. But isn't it what they do? That's the key to be able to stop the drugs.
Well, what happened with the police officers? They got a contract now with which I would have never even thought of. That basically, if you get a promotion today,
yeah,
from a sergeant to a lieutenant,
yeah,
you can retire tomorrow as a lieutenant and get your pension like that.
Oh, yeah.
You know, you get promoted and you get a pension.
Yeah.
At that amount right away. And the city, I think their budget, I was a good friend. The guy had just retired not long ago. He was there when I was there.
Uh-huh.
He lives down in South 10th Street. With his mother, and but the whole thing is, you know, so many politicians, they put their party and themselves before the people who elected them.
Yeah.
And that's what gets me upset.
Okay.
I mean, when they elected me and they said they would like to have this done, I always wanted to do something better.
Yeah.
Or which should include that, you know.
Right, yeah.
Something more. And like I think I was the last one that had a balanced budget.
Okay.
But and I have no problem in believing that I could have got reelected.
Okay.
But I told you that before, the newspaper hated me.
Uh-huh.
I don't know why, I never said anything to them. I used to be a paper boy when I was young.
Oh yeah.
And but the whole thing is with the Reading Eagle, they kept saying, Eppihimer, he's only a plumber. Eppihimer, he's only a plumber. And it just got to the point where, you know, you just don't want to put up with it anymore.
Uh-huh. It was the press that gave you a hard time.
Yeah.
All right?
And then what happened?
Yeah.
One of their top writers.
Yeah.
I hired him as my assistant.
Okay.
His name was Kevin Cramsey.
Oh, and did he help to change that narrative?
Well, him and one of the other, his buddy that still was there.
Yeah.
They used to do whatever they could.
Okay.
But because Kevin Cramsey, I still call him every now and then.
Okay.
And, you know, that's a long time ago.
Right. Yeah, very interesting to see. Now, I see the problem in Reading being countered by like the Olivet Boys and Girls Club.
Yeah.
You know, that effort that they did there got education and sports putting things together for the community. Do you think that kind of thing helps to eliminate gangs and
with a couple of friends that we'd always every now and then we'd just go down to the Olivet Boys Club.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not far from my house, you know.
Right.
It ain't that far. But I mean, it just seems as though I think that's why we're having all these killings and everything and that stuff too. It just seems as though there's not enough stuff for kids to be busy at. But the thing is, I mean, I hate it when I turn the TV on at night, and just like today, when I was looking at the paper out there, this brother killed his 11-year-old brother.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, where's your pride and the things you have that you love your brother and your family? I mean, to me, family is everything.
Yes.
And when I was the mayor, the city was my family.
Yeah, that's right.
Not just my wife and my kids.
Right. Well.
And that's who I looked out for. I tried to look out to and do whatever I could was best for them.
Yeah. Well.
And like I told you, that pastor wanted to come up and look at my house and that stuff, you know.
Yeah.
We want Mary Jo back and that stuff, but I deep down in my heart,
yeah,
I've always felt bad that I never ran again because I just felt that I could have got elected again.
Yeah. Well, you know, what do you think about, you know, I understand on the council at the time that you were the mayor, Vaughn Spencer was a councilman. Was he the head of council at that time?
That I don't know.
Oh, yeah.
I
thought
because I'll tell you what, I knew Vaughn Spencer when he was a teacher.
Okay.
For the school district. And when I found out what he did and everything like that,
yeah,
it irritated the heck out of me.
Yeah.
Because I said, Vaughn, with his pension from the school district
and
that stuff and from city, from whatever else hit money, I'm sure he had a lot of money.
Yeah.
And then to do stuff like that. I felt so bad about it. But, you know, I was in no, I had no power. And I only had power when I was in the office.
Yeah.
And I never, never thought of taking anything that I shouldn't have had.
Right.
I never took a raise in pay.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I've always been, I was always there for the people of Reading. And you can talk to some of the older people in Reading that knew me.
Yeah.
And they'll tell you, they'll just tell you right out that anytime we wanted to talk to the mayor, we could talk to him.
Good. Yeah.
I mean, I had an open door.
All right. Yeah. Well, you know, but it's still, it's a good city, you know. You know, having come from New York where it was a different kind of high speed everything, to come to Reading was a very, very interesting and lovely experience for me.
Yeah.
You know, I did a little church in Glenside, Christ Lutheran.
Right next to the school.
Yeah, right.
The elementary school.
Yeah, I was right there. So what I did was what I had always done, that was to start a basketball team. And we would play Olivet Boys and Girls Club, you know. So, you know, I got my kids working hard to be good, you know, and so that we were competitive against those kids, you know, that would come to Olivet Boys and Girls Club. Just the other day, one of the kids that I coached, he was 10 years old, 20 years ago, came up to me and said, "Don't you remember me?" I saw this guy in the mall. Says, I said, "No, I don't. You know, you look like a brother." He says, "You coached me when I was 10 years old on your basketball team for Christ Lutheran." Talk about a blast from the past, you know, to be able to get that.
Well, that's nice when you hear from people like that.
Yeah.
it makes you proud.
Yeah.
It makes you proud. And makes you feel, I mean, just like when I was a mayor, I mean, I never thought that I came first.
Right.
I mean, it was the city and the people.
Yeah.
And I had a lot of people that say to me, "Why did you ever leave? Why did you ever leave?" And I even felt, my wife felt worse than I did.
Yeah.
Because I knew a little bit about politics.
Yeah.
And the Reading Eagle paper always loved to talk about the politics.
Yeah.
In the negative sense.
Yeah.
Not in the positive sense.
Right.
But, and then, like I said, I hired one of their best reporters as my first lieutenant, like, in my office.
Okay.
And his name was Kevin Cramsey. And, I mean, him and his buddy used to even tell me about the newspaper.
Yeah.
Even though they worked there.
Yeah.
But, no, it's, I love to think about it, but, you know, thinking about it now is too late.
Oh, well, the thing is, it's never too late to be able to have an opinion about how we can be better, in our world now. You know, you've had this experience as being the mayor in a difficult situation, and there are hints that you can give to the people who are now trying to figure out what they need to do, because many of the problems that you had, they still have, right?
I guess, yeah.
So the thing is, there are suggestions that we can make that perhaps they can use as to try to help solve the problem. And you saw back in the day where families were not intact. You came from an intact family, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And how that was a really basic thing that enabled you to be successful in taking over a difficult job like the mayor.
Well, my uncle that got me at my plumber's apprenticeship,
yeah,
he lived two doors away from us. and my grandmother lived next door to him.
Oh boy!
On Linden Street, we the Eppenheimers controlled Linden Street.
See, and you better be right, right? Yeah, you know, I bet you your grandmother was one of the people that kept her eye on you, and if you didn't do right, she would get on you.
Well, that's just like now, where I live in my house, where I built my house.
Yeah.
53 years ago when we got married.
Yeah.
My wife and I, it's 54 years in February this year.
Right.
Coming up. But when we built our house, when I didn't even know my wife yet.
Yeah.
But the city sold the land.
Yeah.
And because there was a dirt road.
Okay.
14th Street was a dirt road.
Uh-huh.
And on the side of the street where I built my house, that used to be older people. Well, my grandfather was one of them.
Okay.
That's Grandpa Eppihimer. They had gardens.
Yes.
So I bought the land that where my grandpa had his garden.
Okay.
For $1,000.
Uh-huh.
From the city. And then I could have bought the whole city block for $5,000. But back in those days, $5,000 was like $25,000
today. Yeah, that's right, yeah.
When we built that house, because I remember 14th Street as a kid.
Yeah.
Because I was born and raised at 14th and Buntwood, across from the Hillside Pool.
Okay.
I slept in a crib till I was 10 years old.
Uh-huh.
Because we didn't have beds.
All right.
I mean, that's how things were.
Yeah.
And there were 17 of us lived in a row home.
Wow.
My grandfather and then my three aunts and my mom.
Uh-huh.
And their families.
Wow.
And when I was 10 years old, my dad moved to the 500 block of Linden Street. 537 Linden Street. And we lived there until I met my wife and got married.
Uh-huh.
And then the city was selling the land up behind my dad.
Uh-huh.
Where my grandfather's garden was. And I bought a lot for $1,000. And I didn't even really think about marriage yet, you know, but I just bought it for, I don't know why I even bought it at the time. But I guess because it meant something to me with my grandpop.
Yeah.
But what happened, I could have bought the whole city block for $5,000, but like $5,000 was $25,000 in those days.
Yeah.
But right across the street where the girls' softball field is now, where they play soccer and the high school and that stuff,
yeah,
that used to be a sand quarry.
Uh-huh.
When I was a kid. And we used to play cops and robbers over there.
Uh-huh.
But I mean, and to me, those were my good old days.
Yes.
But now, up where I live now, almost all the neighbors in that block of mine are still there.
Wow.
I mean, we lost a neighbor, last year. He was 96.
Okay.
And his wife had died a couple years earlier. But, I mean, he'd go out of the house at night and close the door, and he was locked out. And one of our neighbors always had a key. Yeah, we had a key. Just like now, when I go away to my sons, my neighbor gets my key to my house.
Yeah.
And she has the phone number to my son's house and everything.
Yeah.
So if anything turns up, just give me a call.
Yeah.
I mean, so we're still like a family.
Yeah, yeah, right, the whole block, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's, because I always say to people, they say, well, where do you live? I'll say, in Reading. But they'll say, where at in Reading? I said, at the end of Reading.
Yeah.
Before, because across the street is up, there's a mountain.
Yeah.
But, no, I've enjoyed my life here, but we had a place at the down at Myrtle Beach for a while,
mm-hmm.
but then we sold it.
But you had a real family unit, is what you're telling me.
Yeah.
You know, and that's how you grew up, and you had that closeness. So when you got into a position of authority, you looked for that same structure, and people that understood that were able to be successful in your administration.
Well, it's just like now with Al Bosco. I'll tell you what, I'll never forget about Al Bosco, as long as I can have a mind. But out there where his dad had to open the store, the first store on 9th Street, they tore all that stuff down now. And what happened, we honored Al Bosco.
Yeah.
I put a big sign up when I was mayor.
Yeah.
And a big metal sign honoring him and his father for the store and that stuff. And that was the first time I ever saw Al Bosco cry.
Uh-huh.
But I remember going there to the store when I was a little boy.
Yeah.
You'd walk up into the building, and there'd be like two showrooms on each side, one on each side, and you'd have an aisle walking up to it.
Yeah.
And then right inside the door was a machine.
Mm-hmm.
As a kid, you'd put your feet in the machine so they could, your mom and dad could find out what size shoe you'd take. We always used to look forward to sticking our feet in.
Yeah.
But it's, and like I said, I helped many a person. I've helped people get elected. I supported them and that stuff. But it just seems as though all you hear nowadays is about a shooting here, a shooting there.
Yeah.
And when you hear some of the stuff where, just like out down there in Mexico now, where that whole family was.
Yeah, family, yeah.
All those little kids.
Yeah.
Children, I mean, that really irritated me.
Well, how do we stop that, is what I'm asking you.
Well, they were Muslims.
Yeah.
And the thing is, they were living there.
Yeah.
And they wanted to come back home, I guess. And I think the cartel...
Yeah.
Attacked their cars and thinking they were some of the enemy.
They made a mistake.
Yeah.
Right.
But it was too late.
Yeah, right.
When you let fire, like, with machine guns in a car.
Yeah, yeah. Because they thought it was an SUV, you know, the kind that they thought another gang.
That's why I'm all in favor of closing the border.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I think you should have to go through a procedure to get into the country.
Yeah.
And there's too many of them was breaking through the fence and everything.
Yeah.
And the fence, when I saw the fence, it looked like anybody could break through it.
Yeah, right.
I mean, it was hardly anything to it.
But do you think that you can stop it with a wall? I think... You have to stop the market for drugs.
Oh, that's I mean, if people weren't using their drugs, it'd be a lot better off. Just like now, the apparatus that they smoke with.
Yeah.
I mean, you hear where so many people died already, and yet these other young people keep doing it.
I know. So you have to stop that, and to educate our kids that vaping is harmful to you.
Yes, it is.
All right?
Yep.
And, you know, not just vaping, but now vaping with cannabis, with pot. You know, my goodness.
Right.
What are we doing?
Yeah, well, like me, I never smoked.
Right. What? There
my,
it
my,
is.
My, when we were kids, my cousin and my two cousins, they tried to get me to smoke.
Right.
But I wouldn't do it.
Okay. Well, see, there again.
And both of them are dead.
Okay, see, and you had a family that would appreciate your stand that you didn't smoke.
Yeah, my dad smoked cigars all the time.
Yeah.
But my dad lived to be 80, up in his 80s.
Right.
Just like I'm getting there.
Yeah, well, that's a special club. That is a very special club, you know, being 80. I was born in 1939.
I was born in 38.
we're in the same club.
Well, that's why we talk a lot together.
You know?
No, so. I just, like I said, Reading still is not the way it was when I grew up.
Okay, yeah.
You could walk the streets at night.
Yeah.
Your daughter or your son could walk the streets, and you never had to worry about them.
Right.
Now, a lot of times you have to worry about, because I even have a tendency to do it. When I'm walking and somebody comes up behind me, I turn around, you know.
Quick, yeah, right. Got to be quick.
You never know.
That's right, yeah. So we got, I think it's education. You got to educate people, take them out of, so the way to counter the gangs in Brooklyn was to give them a different way to see family. They will, if they didn't have family at home, all right, you know, the father was somewhere else, mom was working, they needed to have family, and they would develop family out of their gang. That would be their structure, and then they would get into all kinds of nonsense, right?
Uh-huh.
So the only way that you could really change them is to give them an insight into how you can behave. So I would take those Brooklyn kids, because I lived at that time in Staten Island, and I would take them over to Staten Island to go horseback riding. That was something totally different in their experience.
I had a pony when I was a little boy.
Oh, yeah, see? Right. And you know what that does to kids.
It was a black and white pony. His name was Tiny.
Okay.
And he used to come, when I lived at 14 in Bunwood, my grandfather owned the garages in a bunch of garages in the back.
Yeah.
And one of them was the pony's house.
Okay.
And when we were eating supper at night in the dining room,
yeah,
he'd come over and he'd stand at the window and look for leftovers.
Oh, yeah.
But it's, I just wish people today would think everybody's part of your family.
Yes.
I mean, and just get along with each other. I mean, I know it's tough with some people.
Yes.
But it's the best thing for the country and for the people.
So that's the solution, is what you're saying.
Yeah.
Family.
Yep.
That's what you're saying. Well, okay. The gospel according to Joseph Eppe. Family. That's, you know, that's what you're telling me.
Yeah, family means a heck of a lot to you.
Yes.
It has a lot of impressions on you.
Yeah.
And as far as your training, it's almost like you're going into training as a kid.
Yes, sir. That's right.
You know.
Right. My grandmother had one phrase that has lived with me forever. She would say, tell me what to do, and she would then underline it by saying, and you better would. I would say, what kind of language is that? You better would.
Well, my mother never, she was a stay-at-home mom.
Yeah, right.
And my dad worked.
Yeah.
I mean, my mom was always with us kids.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, there it is, when you have that.
You have that connection.
Yeah, that's right. And somebody that would be able there guiding you. And that's what these kids that I was street club working, the gangs, they didn't have an adult who was going to accompany them and to be able to interpret what was actually happening in the street.
Okay. No, it's a lot easier said than done.
Yeah.
But, you know, you can always try.
Yeah. Well, what do you think, then, that we need to do? We need, in terms of the leadership of not just in the home, but also in terms of the heroes, the athletes, the politicians, the president of the United States. Well, how about all those things?
Well, one thing the main thing in my mind is when you get elected to office.
Yes.
It's not about you or the party, it's about the city.
Thank you.
Like I told you, I never took a raise. I had 210 cops, police officers.
Right.
And I mean, I had full, City Hall was full.
Yes.
With people. Now you see a lot of empty offices in there.
Right. Well.
But like I said, the city, when you're elected to represent the city, that should become your priority.
Yeah.
Not just your job.
Okay. Well, don't you think that's true? Should be true of the president of the United States?
Oh yeah. I mean, whoever is president.
Yeah.
I mean, I just disagree with both candidates and him on some of the stuff that are said.
Yes.
I mean, why don't they? They're elected by the people to represent the people.
Yes.
Why do they just represent the parties?
Thank you.
I mean, that's what I just...
Yeah, that's right.
I just can't put up with that. Why they're always out after each other.
I know.
Yeah.
Right. And they're supposed to be for the people, by the people, for the people. You know, and,
yep.
And that was my take on that, you know, as to how you're supposed to govern, right?
Well, before we leave, I just want to say
I
appreciate your invitation to come tonight.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I'm sure we'll talk again.
Yes.
One way or another.
Yeah.
And I appreciate this young woman here, all she's done for us. This has been the first time I've been here for a long time.
Yeah. Well, you think
when she was a little girl, yeah.
But, you know, when you think about the people that really put this thing together to allow us to be able to express our views, to be on television, you know, I think that's, you know, Miss Ann and some of the people that have served at BCTV, it's just amazing, you know, the volunteer. You're a volunteer, right?
Yeah. An intern,
right. Kutztown?
Albright.
Oh, yeah? Mm-hmm. Great. So, you know.
I used to have a scholarship for girls in Reading. But it had to be you had to live in Reading. And we just gave out our last two scholarships, our last three scholarships, I should say, 2 years ago. And almost all of the girls are going to be nurses. That's why I ran into some nurses when I was in the hospital.
And they were part of the program, right?
Yep.
So it's really good. Well, we thank you for your service there, Epi. Thank you for all that you've done for our lovely city, because irregardless of whatever they say about Reading, we still love the place.
Well, I just want to thank you for giving me the opportunity to be here.
Yeah, well.
And I know we'll talk on the phone or when we see each other.
Yeah,
or whatever.
That's right.
So I really appreciate it. I hope I did okay with the interview and and talking.
Yeah. You shared your life with us, and we appreciate it.
Well, like I said, as a kid, I didn't have much. I mean, my dad, even when I went away to college, he lost his job that first year.
Right. Well, we have to say goodbye. But we do that with a great deal of joy because we have actually seen a great man in Mayor Joseph Eppihimer.
Well, I want to thank you for inviting me, and God bless everybody.
Okay. Take care.
Courageous Conversation on BCTV is supported by Brentwood.